I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, to begin tonight's meeting, I'm going to ask our county manager to talk about county government 101.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And tonight, we do want to recognize our participants in County Government 101. And as the board's aware, we did this as a two-day event back last fall. We did it in the evening, took about 3 hours each evening, but it was really a very successful time, and we had some really good feedback from those that participated, so we decided to really expand what we did. One of the reasons we decided to expand is we only met in this room, and one of the things we felt like is that we needed to show people what we did. And we needed to visit the facilities, and we wanted them to visit our staff to show the services that we provide in Alamance County. So we took our show on the road. It really was a 7-week commitment. And again, I want to thank the participants for that, and it was very well attended. But again, we talked more than just budget. We talked about what we did on a daily basis and the different services that we do provide that most people are unaware that we do. We started with county government at here at the county government building. We gave a budget preview and oversight of what we do and HR and county commissioners, and we also did queues with registered deeds. We then took it on the road and went to the landfill. I had a tour of the landfill, and but we also had presentations from inspections, planning, and environmental health. After that, we went to the Ag Building, where we talked with Cooperative Extension, Soil and Water, and Recreation and Parks. After that, we went to the Sheriff's Department, looked at equipment that they have, but also had a really good tour of our jail. Then we went to our EMS main base, which is here in Graham. I appreciate all of the emergency management from everything from CCOM to emergency management, fire marshal, and EMS did that as well. Then after that, we went to Graham Library, and that's where the Board of Elections, the library, and Veteran Services made presentations. And then our last meeting was at the Health and DSS Human Services Building. And appreciated Susan and Stacy for that, their presentations. Again, want to thank all of our participants, especially want to thank Tori Frank. Tori handled a lot of logistics and the advertisement, working with Scott on our website. So I do want to thank Tori for her work on that. But also wanted to thank our department heads, and they went above and beyond really to make this a worthwhile experience for those that attended County Government 101. And we want to thank the participants because, again, they were kind of our guinea pigs. And so they got the first round of it. Hopefully we learned some things and we can do some things a little bit different. But we'll continue to improve. And the goal that we have is to do this twice a year. And we really want to open it up for about 12 to 15 people at a time. So with that said, I'll turn it back to you.
All right. Very good. Well, I'm going to come down, and each one of you, we have you a certificate for putting up Craig that long. Anyhow, I'll bring that down and hand them out.
Guy Sinclair.
Couldn't make it.
Okay. Lori Bryan. There you go.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Earl Piggy.
And if you would like to stay up, we'll take
yeah,
the picture.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
And we'll put it on the website.
Yeah, come on up here. Yeah, just hang out up here a minute. Y'all can all hang out together. How about that? Julie Brown Clark. Pamela Thompson. Ellen Ritter.
She couldn't make it.
Okay. Lori Barker. Netta Pickett. Counties with the recovery from Hurricane Matthew, and we had a number of those patrolmen that went down, we got them a certificate. We had 12 officers that went to Robeson County, and they assisted with security, emergency shelters, traffic control, security patrols, and delivery of flood relief supplies. And the fire marshal office had a couple of guys that went down and helped, and the emergency management, Matthew Kimnitz, was sent to Edgecombe. Yeah. He got put in charge of something, it looks like, here as a planning chief for the incident management team. Health and environmental help went down. We had 5 employees went to Beaufort County, and they assisted with restaurant inspection, medical needs, and so forth. And we've got certificates for all of you, and thank all of you for what you do. Debbie and I were talking earlier. It's amazing how North Carolina has so many emergency personnel that work together across our state, and we're blessed. We really are here in this state to have the people and the dedication to serving others, and that's exactly what it is. So we've got you a certificate. I know that's not a whole lot probably for sleeping on cots and whatever else you had to do while you were there, but thank you very much. And to start out, Terry Craver. And y'all come up here and stand too, the ones we can. Corporal Zach Knee. Lieutenant Tony Williams. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Deputy Taylor Ray. Deputy Richard Minnick.
Thank you, sir. sir.
Janice Tilly. Sergeant Josh Hayes. Jess Quinn. Deputy Ethan Lowe. Deputy John Clay.
Thank you, sir.
Elizabeth Elmore. And DSS Economic Service Division. I don't know who's here to receive that, I guess.
So Nanette and Tabitha are here.
Okay.
They did 1,000 food stamp applications for Robeson County.
Wow.
For the two of you.
All right, thank you.
And y'all just line up in front of these guys here. Okay. Deputy Craig Stevens. Corporal Brad Hall. Christy Allred. Okay. Deputy Chad Lloyd. Thank you very much. Bessie Meeks. Corporal Adam Kozark. Corporal, hey, you get two. You must have went twice. Anyhow, thank y'all so much for what you did. And Joey Holmes. I didn't have one. Oh, there it is. Got sorry. I think that's all of them. We just had two Adam Kozarks. All right. Very good. Thank y'all very much.
And Mr. Chairman, where's John Payne? We also have some units from our volunteer fire department are down also helping in the west on the brush fires. Jesse, you want to?
Yes, sir. Right now we do have, just got back this actual weekend. We have the E.M. Holt Fire Department, Fawcett Fire Department, Hall River Fire Department, Elon Fire Department, AO Fire Department. All sent personnel and apparatus to the mountains to help with, well, wildfires.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Let me ask one of the deputies. Is Deputy Neese still here? I like to check up on the sheriff all the time that I can. What did you see, if anything, Deputy, difference in Alamance County Sheriff's Department and what goes on in Robeson County?
The level of professionalism that we have at our county is astounding compared to down there. The organization, they were suffering from a massive hurricane. However, us stepping in, I can tell it helped. But I could tell that our organization and the way we work together was very different from down there. We've got a culture of professionalism, and it showed through.
All of you feel the same way?
Absolutely. Yes, sir. Very good. All right.
Who was protecting Alamance County all that time?
Sheriff and Jackie.
Oh,
<Brett.
laughs>
Jackie.
Yeah.
Oh,
old guys.
Yeah, old guys. They don't sleep well on cots. Next, we have Judge Jim Robertson here to make a special presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. It's been a long time since I've had the privilege of standing in front of you speaking. I've got kind of a different gig going on, and I don't get back home, and I kind of miss you. But thank you. I always consider it a privilege to be able to speak to you. Thanks for a brief spot on your agenda here. I think it's appropriate that this presentation be made on a night in which we acknowledge county employees who are doing way above and beyond the call of duty. That level of professionalism, the sheriff and I were just talking about that prior to your question, Judge Smith. So it just reinforced what is observed here amongst the judiciary and other law enforcement agencies as well. So. Mm-hmm. So it's just an important night that you're recognizing folks who do that. Now, as you know, the Alamance County Clerk of Court office is the employees there are state funded. They're state employees. But to the general public, I'd say that most folks still view it as the Alamance County Clerk of Superior Court office, and they don't really see a difference because of the revenue stream that funds this. And so when they go to the clerk's office and see individuals who go far beyond the call of duty, that reflects well on us as a county and the county commissioners and the county government as well as the state. And so with that in mind, I'm going to ask a colleague and a friend of mine who's now retired to step up to the podium with me. I'd like Donna Harris to step up here, please. Donna was with the clerk's office for decades despite her youthful appearance and in various roles. Primarily, she's probably most known for being in charge of the child support department. Not the easiest position to take, but she earned the respect of folks receiving child support and the folks paying child support, which is an amazing accomplishment on her part. Prior to her retiring a few months ago, and for a period of time of months and months leading up to that, she was also involved in the development and nurturing of our national award-winning domestic violence electronic protective order system. That was created, envisioned here, born here, nurtured here, grew here, and piloted here. And thanks to a grant to the state of North Carolina, over the next 3 years, we'll now, that program that started right here in your county with your blessing and help, will serve 50% of the population of the state of North Carolina. Wow. But it's because of folks like Donna Harris, among others, collaboratively doing this. So our mutual friend Lash Reitenberry communicated with me one day and said, how can we best recognize Donna for these years of service above and beyond the call of duty? And we were in agreement that it needed to be done. He facilitated that, and he's asked me to have the privilege of presenting that to you in front of you here at a meeting and I almost said open court, in an open meeting here for the commissioners. So in recognition of many years of service beyond the call of duty, the compassion which she had for the public servant aspect of her entire life, and she's a great person and a person that needs to be recognized, the governor of the state of North Carolina has asked me to present to Donna Harris the Order of the Longleaf Pine. So this, this says well for the clerk's office, it says well for Donna, us friends of Donna, but it also says well for our county.
Yeah.
That is recognized so highly by the state of North Carolina, the most prestigious civilian award. Thank you for a minute of your time to allow me to present that in front of you at the commissioner's meeting.
Thank you, Donna, for your work. All right. We did not have anybody sign up for public speaking, but if you'd like to speak, anybody from the floor, you're welcome to. I know it's a lot of folks out in the hallway. Just want to make sure everybody had an opportunity. Also like to welcome Mr. Lashley and Ms. Gailey tonight, our incoming commissioners. Glad to have you with us tonight. Any responses to no comments? Okay. All right. Next, we'll move on to the approval of the agenda. If we can get a motion.
So moved.
All right. Thank you, David. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
And the consent agenda, is there anything on there that we need to pull, look at?
I move approval.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Okay. Next, we have a public hearing for the proposed economic development incentives for GKN Driveline North America.
There's Mac. I'll turn it over to Mac and let Mac introduce.
Okay, very good.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm Mac Williams, President of the Alamance Chamber, happy tonight to bring to you Chet Roslanowicz, who is a vice president of GKN. They are considering an expansion of the Alamance facility, and it's a nice addition to the nice run of announcements that we've been having these last few years. It's always fun to work with an existing industry in the same way we work with new industries that might be looking for a brand new location here, to also work with existing companies that are also making significant investments and creating good jobs. And so supporting that growth is as important as supporting anything new coming in as well. And so it's in that spirit that I introduced Chet Roslanowicz, Vice President with GKN, to talk to you about GKN and its presence here in Alamance and the proposal that they're considering. So with that, Chet, I know you have a presentation, a PowerPoint to give, and so with that, I'm going to introduce you to come up and talk about GKN's fine presence in this county and in this state.
Thanks, Matt.
Glad to have you here.
Chairman, Commissioners, thank you. For those that don't know GKN, I'm going to take you through as quick as possible here, not to keep anybody too long. GKN is a corporation. Basically, we have four operating divisions. Aerospace, Driveline, which I'm part of, and that's what's here in North Carolina. Powder Met, we do have one Powder Met plant over in Conover, and Land Systems. Tell by the pie chart on the left, Driveline, the part that we're part of, and the plant in Alamance County, is the largest component of GKN. Driveline at a glance, basically there's somewhere over 27,000 of us around the world in 46 manufacturing locations in 23 countries. The blue part of the pie chart in the middle is the CVJ systems. That's what's produced here in Lee County, Alamance County, and Person County. The yellow, the all-wheel drive geared components, are the two facilities we have over in Catawba County. The customer chart on the bottom right basically is a snapshot of whoever builds cars anywhere in the world. If somebody builds a car, there's something from GKN on that car somewhere. Where Driveline is in the world, the red dots are manufacturing locations around the globe. The yellow dots, primarily, there's one in South America and Colombia. The rest are pretty much in Asia and China and around, are joint ventures. And the green dots are our corporate office engineering centers. In the U.S., ours is in Auburn Hills, Michigan. Basically, we break our business down and drive line into three product groups: drive shafts, which is what is primarily produced here in Alamance; all-wheel drive products, which are the gearboxes and drivetrain components made over in Catawba County; and the growing, the fast segment that everyone wants to talk about is e-drive. We currently are winning quite a bit of business. We don't produce any of that in the U.S. yet, but that's probably going to change soon with some of the orders that we've just won. What's driving our growth primarily are two really big trends going on. One is obviously the legislation and economy for lightweight and reduction of CO2 emissions. The chart on the bottom left shows you that the U.S. is far behind the rest of the world when it comes to reduce CO2 emissions. We've made a lot of progress in the last few years, but we're still the most laggard country in the world when it comes to that. We're still far more polluting than anybody else. That's driving the auto companies with all the new legislation, the fuel economy standards, to reduce weight, redesign vehicles, come up with hybrid electric vehicles, etc. The other trend on the right is what's called global trends and what's termed mega platforms. To give you an idea, is the Volkswagen MQB platform in the bottom right corner. It is exactly the same chassis, drivetrain, everything produced every country in the world where VW makes that. And it's 9 million vehicles off that same drivetrain. For people like us, GKN, who happen to have 46 manufacturing locations around the world, we can replicate that exact drivetrain any place in the world for Volkswagen. So it's a competitive edge for us to be in the global footprint we have, and that's driving a lot of the business change for us, as we've won a lot of business in the U.S. with many customers, including Volkswagen. If you look at this of a drivetrain of a vehicle, and I don't want to get too technical for everyone here, but the blue parts you see up there are what we make in North Carolina. The shafts in the bottom left side, the prop shaft and the half side shaft in the upper left corner are what we make here in Sanford, Alamance, and Roxboro. The gearboxes at the back and at the front are what's made over in the Catawba County plant in Newton. There's a lot of e-drive components, e-drive transmissions on the right. That's the new technology that GKN is driving out into the market, and we're becoming more and more successful with that. The differentials up in the top across there are produced at our Bowling Green, Ohio plant. But basically, if you're designing an all-wheel drive vehicle, we can provide the entire drivetrain for the vehicle. We do that on a couple of key platforms here, just to give you a little bit of the technology. The Land Rover Evoque on the left, and the Fiat B-SUV, or as a lot of us call it, the little Jeep that's out there today, are drivetrains that we provide complete technology from the engine all the way to the wheels is GKN. But what's really driving it, if you look at the left, everything in green on that vehicle, when you're not in four-wheel drive, all those components stop turning. Unlike conventional all-wheel drive vehicles where all the gears are engaged all the time, the new technology is what's called disconnect technology. GKN actually patented the clutches that do that. We produce them over in Newton. And what it does, it disconnects all those components on the vehicle that don't have to turn when you don't need them. It basically produces a 5% fuel savings on the vehicle and reduces, obviously, the CO2 emissions. On the right, the Fiat B-SUV is the same type of technology that's out there. It's a 3-5% fuel savings on the smaller platform, smaller vehicles. But that technology has been driven a lot by the fact that more and more people want all-wheel drive vehicles. And unlike the days, and I'll date myself here, of the Dodge Power Wagon, where you needed a rope ladder to climb up in the four-wheel drive vehicle, everyone, including all the ladies in my life, want all-wheel drive vehicles that are like a passenger car. You get in, they're not high or anything else. What's afforded that technology is GKN has eliminated the hooks joints in the vehicle and put constant velocity joints, which allows that whole vehicle to sit lower and not have any vibration and that type of thing. So it's a lot of technology change, and a lot of that technology is being produced here in Alamance County. Aerospace is the second largest group of GKN. The closest aerospace plant to us right now is in Orangeburg, South Carolina. And for those, as Dan and I were talking earlier, who think of the Honda BizJet, the Honda BizJet fuselage, the two sides, the clamshells of that body, are composite clamshells made by GKN in Alabama and shipped up here for assembly into the Honda. It will soon be moved. That production is going to be moved to Orangeburg, South Carolina. We fought very hard a couple years ago to try to get that business in North Carolina, but we lost out to South Carolina in that. Powder Met is the one plant we have in North Carolina over in Conover. What's unique about Conover is the only all-aluminum plant for sintered in the world for GKN. As all the automakers are trying to reduce weight, more and more components are being looked at in aluminum, and GKN produces our own powders and composites. Haganus division, that green bar in the middle pie up there, Haganus is our division that makes our powder. It is located in Gallatin, Tennessee, right on the TVA grid, because we use a lot of electricity to explode solid metals to make it back into powder. But by doing that, we can come up with our own composites that now we have aluminum components that are as strong as ferrous metal. So there's a lot of new technology going into vehicles that are lighter weight because of that. Land Systems is a group of lots of different businesses. Some people who are maybe part of the ag business may know of Waltershide Power Takeoff Shafts or Waltershide Products. That's all a GKN company. We also make all the wheels for Caterpillar, John Deere, all the big companies out in the Midwest. There's lots of different businesses. We also make the gearboxes for the wind generation systems in Land Systems. So it's a conglomerate of lots of different businesses. Where GKN is in the United States, there's a little over 12,000 of us in the U.S. now. Where Driveline has plants, Powder Met, Land Systems, and Aerospace. You see the cluster around North Carolina. Our largest single populace as far as employees in any state is North Carolina at the moment. Where we are in North Carolina today, this is the headcount. Whoops. What did I touch? Okay. This was as of the end of June. There were 3,200 of us, 829 in Alamance, just under 700 in Roxborough, and Sanford's just over 300 now. The green is Conover, that's the sintered plant, and Newton is around close to 1,500 right now. This is the employee growth in North Carolina over the last 10 years, and what you can see is a very significant growth since the turndown of 09, which was the low point. We've tripled our employment count in North Carolina and expect to continue on with that. The project we have right now at Alamance, if you think of the little game that we all had as kids with the little blocks and you move the little squares around to get everything lined up, the Alamance plant is that little game right now, and it's missing that open square. That blue dot on there is a building expansion to afford us the opportunity to start relaying out and bringing in some new technology, new equipment into the Alamance plant. Competition for that business today is our operations in Mexico and our operations in Brazil. We have exact duplicate of our footprint in North Carolina, exists in the state of Guanajuato in Mexico, and sits in Porto Alegre, Brazil. So when we look at the investments and expansion, those are the three areas we look at in the states. Right now, this is the option of choice. Obviously, the state incentive offered helps facilitate that from a decision standpoint. With that, thank you.
Very good.
Questions?
Chet, you might want to mention the jobs and the wages that would come up.
Yeah, the project basically adds 302 jobs to North Carolina over the next 5 years, actually 4 years. 159 of those are in Sanford, Alamance, and Roxborough. The balance of about 140 are in Catawba County. Total investment in the CBJ plants here is $67 million. Investment in Catawba County is about a little over $100 million. Basically, it is equipment expansion. There's new products being launched, new technology being implemented and put into the plants. So that's what the growth is about. That's what the investment is for. What's been offered up has been a J-dig for each of the two divisions separate, but a $500,000 customized training pack with the community college system. ACC has been particularly supportive of us. They've done a great job on the training for us. They've obviously kicked off the mechatronics program, right, which Dr. Gatewood blames me for that. That's okay. but anyway, he says I threatened him, but I directly didn't. But anyway, we've got a great training plan. And between that and the Career Accelerator Program, we plan to grow a lot of these employees ourselves and get them here in Alamance County.
And just what, Oh, I'm sorry, just to clarify, for Alamance County, for our part, that means we are looking at 40 new jobs at an average wage of $55,000. That is a $28.8 million investment in Alamance County with an incentive of $216,000, and we would pay that over a five-year period, which is $43,200.
And out of that, well, on ours it says $28,800 investment in building and capital. How much is it in building investment?
There's about $1.7 million is in that building addition on there. The rest of it is equipment technology coming in.
And is that coming from out of the country here?
It's coming from everywhere. We actually have a number of our machine suppliers are now, particularly on the machine, on the turning, that side, are U.S. built. There's other technologies that vary from time to time on different parts, but a lot of it is the automation, a lot of it is the built-in inspection capability, all the stuff that go into the new equipment. And a lot of that is our people doing that work with bought-in components here locally.
Okay.
And what would these 40 headcount primarily be doing?
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry, it's 36. We've had some revisions,
yeah.
So it is 36.
It's 36 full-time jobs.
Yeah. I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, let me explain that for a second, because what's happened in GKN is because the business has grown so significantly over the last 2 years, the decision has been to split driveline in two separate. So you saw the pie chart, which was the blue part of CVJ and the yellow part of Geared. Those are now under driveline, but they're two separate divisions. As that happens for driveline, what used to be our operations, our president for the division used to sit in Michigan, now is going to be in North Carolina. So the CVJ division, the managing director for CVJ Americas, who has Brazil, Mexico, and U.S., now sits at the Roxborough plant. His staff is going to be moved into the Alamance plant. So those jobs have been eliminated in Michigan. They're being created down here. There's also a separate division being created over in Catawba County for the all-wheel drive business. So the business has grown to the point that it's gotten to be too big to run as one, so they've now split it into two. Interesting problems to have.
Yeah, it is a good problem.
I just wanted to say thanks.
Yeah.
We know you have choices on where to expand with all your plants, and so we appreciate you deciding to do some expanding in Alamance County. And I'd also like to say thank you for helping with the Career Accelerator program. I think that's so important, working with the Alamance Burlington School System and ACC.
Yeah. It's been a very good program. It's been quite rewarding seeing it actually take off. So, yes. Yes.
Any more questions, commissioners? Okay. Well, thank you very much. We are having a public hearing, so I'll start over here on this side if anybody would like to speak. With none, we'll go to this side. Okay, with that, we'll move on, and I'll entertain a motion to...
So moved.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you very much.
I only have a few.
Oh, more yeah, that's go. Right. Yeah. Actually, I didn't go into it properly, but yes. We'll close the public hearing. Thank you, David. We'll count that as that.
You need another?
Yep, need another motion, sir. All right, thank you, David. All right, David's made a motion to approve this incentive for GKN. Do I hear a second?
Second. You can give it both of them.
Roger, thank you. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? None heard. Thank you very much, sir.
Good. Thank you all very much.
Thanks, Greg.
Thanks, Greg.
Thanks, Clyde. All right. Next up, we have Brian Haygood with the Pig Channel Interlocal Agreement.
Well, good evening, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Commissioners. Here this evening to present you with an agreement whereby the City of Burlington and Alamance County would work together to provide information to the public about our operations via cable television channel 5. I'd like to take just a moment and introduce to you Ms. Rachel Kelly. Rachel is the public information officer with the City of Burlington. Glad to have her here tonight to help in case you have questions about this opportunity. But we've been working with Rachel as she and the City of Burlington have begun to manage Cable Channel 5, which is the public access channel on what was Time Warner Cable. Rachel has met with myself and our county IT folks to discuss what this could mean for Alamance County with the city managing the channel. We would be able to provide our filmed versions of your meetings to the city of Burlington. They would be responsible for the programming that would take place on Cable Channel 5. Burlington would run those meetings, the film versions for us on their channel. We would also, the county would also provide any other productions that we make. You know, we do some film things on occasion. I know Tax Department has done some filming of information for citizens about the revaluation. The city has eagerly said they would work with us to get that kind of information out over Cable Channel 5 also. The agreement indicates, and we've talked about this with the city, that the county would join the city in working to have Cable Channel 5 become our official certified public access channel through the North Carolina Department of Revenue. If we do that, and we're successful doing that, which we feel like we would be successful, we would receive funding from the Department of Revenue to help make Cable Channel 5 work, help keep it technologically up to date. We would receive those funds, and then we would give them to the city to use to help make Channel 5 work. So the agreement that describes all this was in the package. It's pretty simple. It's a one-year agreement. We want to, you know, get a year under our belt, and I'm sure we would be back after, because I'm sure it'll be successful. But the request tonight is for your approval to enter into this agreement with the city. There's no county funds involved in this. It's simply us, for right now, providing copies of your film meetings to the city of Burlington and some other documentaries and things that we have. And we just appreciate Rachel and the city bringing this opportunity to us to get involved. So we'll try to answer any of your questions, and would ask you to consider approving this agreement. So.
I have a question. Would any of that funding help us to upgrade our video to high definition? So we can be at least on par with the city.
Rachel might answer that.
Well, I'm so glad Rachel's here.
Yes. I thought she got lost when I saw her back here.
The Department of Revenue specifies that any of that funding has to go through the support and operation of the PEG channel. As it stands, that would be in the city of Burlington, so I'd have to check in with the Department of Revenue to make sure that we could do that in a different facility. Right now, the city has fronted the money to upgrade our equipment and to provide the server and the software that would program the station.
The city has much of this infrastructure in place now, and tech-savvy staff that would be able to keep it up to date.
And if the board's aware, we've had problems with Time Warner Cable for years. Meetings not being run, run very infrequently and poorly, and it'd be nice to have a partner that we can call directly.
So that will just be a strictly governmental
yes.
channel is what I'm understanding.
It'll be only for relevant government programming. And as Craig mentioned, we have had problems where there's no audio, and there's kind of a middleman with Time Warner, so hopefully this would take it out between the city's contractors handling the technical questions. Another thing is that Time Warner is not required to actually program for us, and with their merger, I think that's something they're planning to get rid of. So it's great that we've got the technology going into place literally this week to run that.
So this would be like the C-SPAN of Alamance County.
It's just Alamance C-SPAN, yes.
Just curious, does Alamance County have a designated slot or an allotted number of hours on this channel? Or
we would be required to provide a minimum of 6 hours and 45 minutes of produced video. So surely the commissioners, your meetings would take a part of that. And then we would be working, we've talked with our IT department, we would be working to produce some other meaningful video content too. Mm-hmm. I think we would also have access to the scrolling text where we can put up public service announcements, you know, the part that comes by and you can read. So.
Yeah, I can see a lot of use for this.
Yeah.
Sounds great.
In that agreement, we do have your meetings running at least twice a week in prime time.
Very good. All right. Well, I have a motion on the floor to approve.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Rachel, for coming down and joining us tonight.
Thank you, Rachel.
Okay, timber appraisal report. I wonder why Rhett was sitting on the front row up here.
I know. Rhett Davis was my first boss back in 1970.
believe it or not.
You couldn't get rid of him then, you still had.
City of Greensboro, not the sites. Anyway, I'm here before you tonight to iron out one little old detail about this logging operation. Bill May, David Henderson, the man himself, is here. He did the appraisal for us for 124 acres of timber we're going to sell at the landfill. And the appraisal value, I think we reported before, is $278,108.60. We've got the bid packet ready to go, but we're here before tonight because we'd like to put in a logging road that would give the landfill a second entrance. And I think the DOT has approved it. And the question is, would the county be willing to pay for the gravel and the grading of that logging road and let those trucks use that to sell the timber and compact it real well for you and create a second entrance for the landfill?
Where would it come in, on the backside of there?
No, it would come in, actually, before you get to the landfill drive. I think it was about a quarter mile before you get to that entrance.
Okay.
It would be...
I've got a map here. So that would make access to the timber a lot easier.
And we could use that after the timber is gone. We could use that for our recycling center.
You got a sizing on what that would cost?
Pardon?
What'd you say the cost of that would be?
Just the gravel, basically.
We would get some bids for that, I think, for that road in, but.
And that would come out of the landfill funds?
I don't think we have any numbers on it just yet. It would be about a 1,500 foot road, which would be approximately 500 feet. Austin Quarter Drive, it would be 500 feet before you get to the existing drive. It would meander back through there to where we're cutting the trees. We could come back with that. We'd come back with a bid for that, but that's what's holding us up. If we can get approval to at least get some bids for that road and get the gravel on it, we'll go ahead and advertise for the sale of the timber.
Okay.
And the timber, I think we'll get some good bids on it. We'll bring those back to you. And
can I ask about that?
Yes.
So we have this appraisal done.
That's right.
So are we expecting bids to come above the appraised value or below or right at? I mean, it seems like you're already having the cat out of the bag.
Well, that's the value of it. I guess it depends on the market.
Whatever the market's bringing is.
How many bidders you get.
Yeah.
And the bidders. And it looks like it's pretty good timber down there. I've got a little experience with cutting trees, but they've done a very good analysis of it. And we've got some sizable trees out there.
And the positive thing about this is, well, if it doesn't, we get bids that are less than the appraised value, we can reject any and all bids.
Right. And that's something we bring back the highest bid to the board.
Right.
What are you asking for?
Asking for approval to go forward and get some bids for this road, to put the gravel road in, and
going into it.
And to advertise for the
bids. On the timber. Okay.
Second on David.
I'm David Henderson, consulting forester out of Ashburn. The road that has been proposed we don't have to have it in order to get timber out. I think it's really something, a win-win situation. It would help the bidding of the timber.
Right.
But the last time the timber was harvested around 8 years ago, the road didn't exist, but we went out through the main entrance, and this would defer the trucks out of the main entrance.
It'd keep traffic away from people who are going into the landfill on a regular basis, and it really comes to our new building. I believe that's our new building that we built down there by the entrance.
And in conversations with Richard, it really does open up for that second access, the property to other opportunities as well.
Do we need to have two separate votes here, I think?
I think if you would just authorize us to go ahead and advertise the bids and then authorize us to submit some bid requests for the gravel for the road, the grading and the road. It would also, I think the long-term plans are to put a couple of scales on this new road as well.
Okay.
For our recycling.
So we can do that all in one motion.
Yeah, that was exactly my motion.
That was exactly what you had on your mind. Very good. Yes. All right. Can I get a second on what you just said?
I'll second it.
Linda seconded that. All right. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you. That's it. Get some good bids coming in. Timber's high right now, or at least it is at the lumberyard. All right. Jeremy Akins, we have him to give us get approval for his schedule of values, and just out of curiosity, have you been busy talking to folks about this over the last?
Rich, you don't have to leave.
Really not.
I'm retired. They got a big place to go and things.
You've had enough.
See you.
Thankfully, I haven't had a lot of conversations about it. There's been very little concern shown, and that's good. Hopefully, that means that it's a good schedule, not just that nobody's looking. I know some folks have looked at it, and so that's good. This is, of course, part three of adopting a schedule of values. In the first meeting, we talked about the proposed schedule, and in the last meeting, we had a public hearing. Today, what I'm asking for is an actual approval and adoption of that schedule as it's been amended. Because obviously, from the first meeting forward, we have gotten some helpful suggestions, and we do propose some amendments, which you'll find in your agenda packet. What I'd like to ask is that the schedule, as amended, be approved. Now, provided that that's done, we'll begin to advertise to the public that it has been approved. There is a 4-week period, a 30-day period, that they could appeal if they wanted to the State Property Tax Commission. That's pretty rare, so with no serious complaints so far, I wouldn't think that would be the case. And thereafter, we'd be set for 8 years as far as that's concerned.
Okay. Do we have any discussion on that? Any questions?
Jeremy and his folks have really done a great job on this, Jeremy. You have. And I'm only glad that I won't be here for the
I'm sure you don't want to come back and just kind of help us out on that.
Okay.
Judge, you got out 8 years ago, right?
I certainly did. Oh, timing.
That's it. All right. If there's no more questions, I'll entertain a motion.
So we'll make a motion.
David, you are fast tonight. Thank you, Roger.
I need to talk to everything.
All in
favor? I
think
he's got it on a recorder over there.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, no opposition. Thank you, Jeremy.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your work. Okay, next up we have Libby Hodges with the Planning Board to discuss a public hearing, set a public hearing.
That's correct. I'm here tonight. Mr. Daniel Lee from the airport, the Burlington Airport, is also here. But we are requesting a public hearing on changes to the height restriction ordinance that they requested. They expanded their runway, and we're changing the ordinance to reflect the changes that they need for their approach. The hearing would be on December 19th.
Okay. So move approval.
Second.
Bob got that one in first.
Thank you.
Made you name.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Maybe that was too easy.
Well, the second one will be just as easy, if you don't mind. Second date, we have some changes that were requested as a result of some changes in the law for environmental health. We added a couple of statements at the end of our subdivision ordinance. While we were in there, there were a couple of typos that we needed to fix, and some loopholes we would like to align some of our requirements, but we're also asking for the hearing on December
5th. 19th.
Sorry, I just totally blanked on that for a second. Same deal.
Okay. All right. Well, do I hear a motion to set a public hearing?
I'll move that one too.
All right. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, David. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Very good. Thank you, Libby. Capital repair. Brian, you're up.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Asking tonight for the commissioners to approve the county to spend $41,475 for two capital projects. The first capital project, the total dollar amount is $29,275. This is for heating and air work to be done here in the county office building. We're having issues with high humidity and condensation in the purchasing and tax listing part down on the first floor. And so the second project is a total of $12,200. This is for sprinkler installation at the gymnasium at the new jail. All these funds will come from projects, capital projects that we've already completed this year, so we're not asking for an additional allocation of fund balance. This is, we've gone back through projects that have been completed, put together enough money through some savings in those projects to pay for both of these. So if I'll be happy to try to entertain any questions.
I was confused on the first one.
Yes.
So is that a separate air conditioning system for that floor?
Well, the purchasing department is actually in civil court. It's through the firewalls over in the civil court side. So we're going to have to do some rerouting of ducts and some work to try to make sure they get good airflow in there. We've been using the system from this side, if I'm not mistaken, and we are going to have to, install a unit and reroute ducts. And the problem is the humidity is so high down there, it's causing condensation to form on the light fixtures. Our air intake are all come around the lights down there, so we've actually had some problems in the tax department with water dripping down on people's desks. So that is a situation that needs to be corrected, as does the sprinklers in the jail gym.
You don't have any mold problem, yeah, or anything like that?
Not yet. It's just started this summer, so we were hoping that we can get a jump on and get it knocked out before next summer, before we experience any other problems.
Well, we don't want Jeremy to get soaked back here in the tax department. At least not to the rebound.
He's going to be sweating.
He might need to get cooled off in. Okay. I'll entertain a motion to approve
this.
Thank you, David.
Second.
Thank you, Roger. All right, any discussion? All right, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, Brent. And you're still up.
Yes,
still up. I'm going to hand you folks a copy of this information. I'm going to go over performance management program. We're recommending some changes to the policy, and that you look at this financial data and approve that we move forward with these numbers based on the policy changes that I'm going to go over here in just a moment. So, you remember back several months ago, may have been even longer, several months, we came before you with the results of the fiscal year 14-15 performance management program. So we're back tonight. We were tasked by the board to go back and review our method of allocating funds out. And we've also taken this opportunity to revisit the program, and we're recommending some policy changes, and I'll go over those quickly for you. One change that we're recommending is that from now on, when departments recommend new goals for the upcoming fiscal year, these will be reviewed by one of our strategic plan subcommittees. The idea is to try to hopefully make our department's goals, or encourage our department's goals, to fit in with our new strategic plan. So as subcommittees put together goals and objectives for the plan, we want to work our performance management program along that same vein.
The way it should work.
Yes. The new goals will be presented with department's budget requests. We haven't done that in the past. So when the department turns in their budget, they're going to have their goals for the year also included in that same information. So the board management will be able to see upcoming proposed budget and what's the plan for that money and how does it tie back into our overall plan. The policy changes also required, goal changes. If during the course of a fiscal year a department wants to change a goal, we used to give them one quarter. We had a weight system. It was kind of confusing. We have done away with that. Goals can be changed, but they require approval by the county manager before a department can change a goal during a fiscal year. Just quickly go over how we're going to allocate the funds out. All savings, any kind of savings that we see, will go to fund balance until the fund balance is at 17%, which we are over that point now. After fund balance is 17%, 25% of the savings right off the top goes into fund balance until the fund balance is 25%. So that's the goal. We're tied into the fund balance policy, trying to get the fund balance to 25%. We have a change here. After 25% off the top for fund balance, we're proposing to take employee bonus amounts off the top of the remaining pool.
So eligible departments and employees, county will just take all the cost of all employee bonuses right off the top. That will be a separate allocation. It won't go to departments for them to figure out whether or not they want to do that. It'll just be taken off the top.
And part of the reason why we recommended that is the smaller departments sometimes do not have the savings, but they still may meet their goals. And the thought process that we wanted to get back is saying, if you meet your goals and you work hard and you're meeting the majority of your goals and you qualify, that there's funds available for you. And we've had instances in the past where some departments did not have any funding to give the $500, and even though they met their performance goals.
And they may have contributed to the overall
yeah.
savings of the entire
right.
group of departments.
Right.
Very well. So another change is after the employee bonus amounts are taken off, we are proposing to take another 5% of the savings pool to create a special project request fund. This is primarily for small departments. Our original policy back in 2012-13 had a mechanism to try to put together some kind of a pool for small departments, again, to have access to money, right? Because they don't, you know, they are so small, they may not be able to save any money of any account. So what we're recommending in the new policy would be 5% of the savings would be taken, the pool, the big pool would be taken off, put into a special project request managed by the county manager. Departments would apply to the county manager and say, I want to do something that's approved in the policy. County manager would then review that request and approve or send it back and say, no, that doesn't meet something that we're trying to accomplish. We did change one, you know, we have a list in the policy of approved expenditures. We did, we removed employee bonuses from that list. That's no longer necessary because we're taking that off the top. We did add a new expenditure type called community outreach efforts. What we were seeing was requests from departments. A good example might be the Board of Elections. The Board of Elections might be interested in using some of their funding to print up voter education handouts, things they can give out when they go out to different community events
stuff.
That they do, or our soil and water department does some educational events. They'd like to be able to use some of the money to do that. We didn't really have an approved use that would let us allow them to do that, so we've titled this community outreach efforts. So it's in the new list of approved expenditures in the policy. And the final change to the policy, we have had specific months that departments would have to come before the board if they wanted to spend more than $5,000. Policy's been amended to allow the county manager to approve expenditures of these funds if they were under $5,000, so they didn't have to come to the board. What we're saying now is a department can, if they want to spend more than $5,000, they have to come before the board, but we're not giving them a month they have to do that anymore. It'll be submitted through the agenda pack just like any other item. So they would come before the board at any time during the year and say, we would like to spend $7,000 to do something. So, I know that's very brief and a very quick rundown of the policy changes, but what we're asking for you tonight is to think about that, consider those changes. If you feel they're acceptable, to move to approve those. And at the same time, what we've done, the numbers that you have in your hand, we took the money from 14-15 and we have broke it down according to the policy that I've just gone over with you. So if you feel comfortable approving the policy changes, we'd ask that you would also approve these numbers, this allocation. I'm going to go over it, and by all means, if at any time you have any questions, I'll try to answer your questions. So for fiscal year 2014-15, we had a pool of money that totaled $2,712,227. That is the county's revenue over its expenditures, right? So we saved money. We brought in more money than we thought we were going to bring in. Together, that came to be $2.7 million. That's the pool we have to work with. When you take that 2.7 and you take away the 25% reduction we just talked about in the policy, for money to go to fund balance, because we're not at 25% yet, that sends $678,056 to fund balance. Then we reduced the pool further by $251,103 because departments didn't meet goals. We have a sliding scale. So as they don't meet goals, they don't get to keep as much money. So $251,000 goes to fund balance. Then we also reduced the pool by $594,767 because we have non-participating departments that we hold their money. A good example would be the DA's office, clerk of court. We also have some special designated funds that when you approve the budget, they're in there to save, to buy something else. We don't count that as savings. If it's budgeted as designated, it's not fair for us to count those as savings, so we don't count those. That puts another $594,000+ in fund balance. So of that $2.7 million, that was revenue over expenditure, $1,523,926 will go to fund balance if you approve this. So on the other side of the equation, we then take the board approved $499,518 to balance this fiscal year's budget. If you remember, we did that, I think, in an effort to try to get some additional funding to Alamance Pearland School System. So that money is now in the budget. That came out of the 2.7 million. The employee bonuses, they totaled $333,706. These have actually been paid, so they have already been accounted to fiscal year 16-17 budget. Then the 5% that would go off out of the pool into the special projects fund for smaller departments and others to apply for totals $17,454. Those go into a balance to be applied for by departments. We do have a $6,000 that we would like to put aside for ICMA software, which we have not moved on. We've mainly been waiting to see, as our strategic plan has finished up, what type of goals are going to come out of the strategic plan. We hate to get too deep into the ICMA software until we have some goals of our own, and then we can see, are there any that match the pool from ICMA. So we haven't forgot about that. We just really have been kind of at a
What is ICMA?
International City County Managers Association. Okay. And what the software does is help with some benchmarking.
Yes.
And on these performance
yes,
goals.
Yes, sir. Okay. And making sure that are we setting accurate goals? Are we being consistent in our goals? And what are we benchmarking ourselves against? You know, we're trying to get that good baseline with this software.
Okay. And the database, though. The comparative database on.
We haven't started it yet. They have a whole list of hundreds of measurements that you can do to be able to compare yourself to jurisdictions all around
so
the country.
So they're still doing that.
We have not started.
No, we haven't, but the ICMA.
Right.
Yes,
so
it doesn't. They are. We just figured
they're doing it. They're changing it up a little bit, and that's one of the reasons why we haven't moved on it as well. There's been some changes at ICMA. About revising how they're doing their database. So we got to get back into that.
Yeah, didn't you present this a couple of meetings ago?
Yes, we had put together the numbers. They were pretty close to this, right, if I'm not mistaken. But we went back. If I remember correctly, I think the board wanted us to go back and look at our numbers again and make sure if we could come up with a better way to allocate this. Yeah. We feel like we have. The final allocation is the $331,923 that will go to county departments and be broke down according to our new formula that takes into account the department's size, the department's budget, the percentage of the savings that they actually contributed. Finance has worked very hard to put that formula together, and we feel very comfortable about it. So I know that was a very quick overview of policy change recommendations and the numbers for 14-15. So certainly we'll try to answer any questions that you have, and hope you'll entertain approving both of these.
One thing I'd like to thank you for is this flow chart that was part of our package, because that really helps understand how
how the fund balance works out. Yeah.
Andrea Rollins in finance put that together, yes, extremely helpful.
And also, I do want to thank Brian and Andrea and Susan, and also we've had a lot of input from our departments as well, because when you start talking about their savings and changing the allocation of how you're doing their savings, there are some questions, there are some concerns, but what we think we've done, and I think most department heads will say, is that we have met their concerns as good as we can. It's not a perfect system, but it's something that we can start with, it's something that we can move forward, and again, if it's not doesn't work out like we think, we can always make changes at it for next year as well.
So has the feature starting at the very top of the list, revenues over expenditures, you mentioned that revenues could have increased or expenditures could have decreased compared to budget?
Yes.
Has it always been that way? Because I was thinking it was primarily focused on the expenses that were saved?
Well, when we, the very first year that we started this program, we focused heavily on the expenditure saved by the departments. But what we were having to do was go back and try to back out revenue shortfalls, because, you know, on one hand, you could have a department save money, but if they miss their revenue projection, they really didn't save everything they you see when you just look at the expenditures, right? Because if they said they were going to bring in $100,000 in departmental revenue, not fund balance, and they missed it by $20,000-$30,000, but they didn't stop any services, they continued to spend, they spent fund balance instead of the departmental
revenue. So you're talking about the revenues in the form of fees that not from property tax revenue or sales tax revenue. Right.
Well, yes, the first year when we looked at it, it was, we were very focused on the expenditures of the department, but you had to take those kind of things into account, the revenues too, because again, you could look at a department and say, well, they saved $80,000, but if they missed their revenue projection or revenues fluctuated, they didn't really save that. You couldn't give them credit for saving everything that appeared to be saved in the ledger sheet. So it got to the point where I think, and I do want to say how much I appreciate Susan and Andrea's patience going through this, because we have been over this method of trying to figure this out and have come up with doing it based on the audit, which is provable numbers we can demonstrate to anybody, to department heads, to the board, to the public. If we base it on the audit, revenues over expenditures, it automatically takes into account, and correct me if I'm wrong, Susan or Andrea, it automatically takes into account a lot of the things that we were going through, picking at, trying to figure out, let's make sure we're fair, let's make sure this is accurate, we're not giving the department too much credit or not giving them enough credit. So, is that accurate?
Yes.
Okay. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Any other questions?
I've always been opposed to this program. I don't think we should be paying employees for saving money. It should be their job to save money. I've always voted against it, which the assistant county manager knows. And I'll have to vote against this also.
Your last vote against.
I take the opposite view. I think it's a best practice management tool that it incentivizes our staff.
This is government. This is not a private corporation.
Principles of management are the same. So I make a motion that we approve it.
All right. We have a motion on the floor to approve your presentation there, Brian. Do I hear a second?
Yeah, I'll second.
Okay, Roger. Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And one opposed. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Okay. Moving along, we're going to get into a budget amendment for legal.
This amendment allows us to place $23,297.20 that Judge Schroeder ordered the DOJ to pay us December of 2015. We got it wired to us September 29th, and this allows it to go back in our budget so we can finalize the payments to the outside law firm.
How much did we owe them? Is this going to cover
$23,297.20?
So that finalizes all our obligations to Kitchen firm.
From our perspective, it does.
Yes.
So basically, in your accounting, yes. That's
what I've been waiting for, so I could get shed of that problem, as we say, down in the country.
All right.
Finally, put it behind us.
Entertain a motion to approve this transfer over.
So moved.
Thank you, David.
So.
Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
All right. Budget amendment for the emergency management, a decon.
Okay. Good evening, Chairman and Commissioners. I'm coming for you tonight. We have received a grant for $78,166 through Homeland Security. This grant will go to purchase two decon trailers. It'll be the trailer and it'll be fully stocked. With us hosting the grant, we get to keep one of those trailers here in Alamance County as ours, and then one will go throughout the region of 11 counties.
meaning be shared among 11 counties?
It's a regional asset.
In decon, does that mean decontamination?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I wasn't sure what we were doing there.
Thank you, Bob. I use acronym, sorry.
So in case of like a hazardous
spill or something, it's what it'll be used for.
How much does it cost to maintain that trailer that we're going to keep?
I really don't know. I mean, it's not a high cost on that.
Okay.
But the fire department.
Sometimes, you know, you get, just like sheriff's case where the government likes to give you money to fund two deputies for 2 years, and then at the end of 2 years,
you got to find the money somewhere.
These supplies aren't used a lot. We will use this trailer to assist, like if we call in the Greensboro regional team to come in and kill, you know, clean up a big spill, we will use that. And our firefighters will have this here on hand to start the decon cleanup before we can get somebody in.
I think we had a situation in the county, didn't we, Clyde, that we had some cleanup that we would possibly need this kind of equipment.
We had an event with a chemical company here, mm-hmm. I guess about 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Where we could use it.
Okay.
But it is 100% reimbursable from Homeland Security, so we'll have to front the money and then get reimbursed.
Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve this.
Second.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Budget amendment for veteran services. Welcome.
First of all, I want to thank the board for approving my new position. I'm very happy about that. You have a budget amendment in front of you that would provide half the year's cost from now to our new budget for the new position. This also includes training, supplies, computer, and the big thing with us, we're going to convert to electronic files. We did get a quote to have them scan them for about $10,000, but Andrea and I have worked together. I'm going to try to implement maybe a tenth to cut that in half.
Okay. Any questions?
You want a motion on
that? Need a motion,
yes, sir.
Please, to approve. Thank you, David. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
How many people in the parade this year?
Well, we estimated it was about 214.
Entries?
Not actually entries, but like the motorcycle club had 6 entries, they ended up being 12. We had all in all 214 entries basically in the parade. Very successful.
Very good. Yeah. It's getting a lot of bands too, I noticed. That
yes. Yes.
All right. Very good. All right. Thank you.
Let me raise one issue here, Mr. Chairman. Mm-hmm. Back when the board, we were considering a new employee to help Tammy out, and the board was very gracious in voting for that. I checked and got some information from the UNC. The veterans bring in, if I read this right, there are a lot of figures here, over $78 million a year into this county in claims. So I'm a little concerned. I don't know if any of y'all are veterans or not. There won't be any veterans on the board anymore, but that's a big chunk of money coming in to Alamance County, and they do a tremendous job. I want to thank Tammy for what she's done. They also sent me some info on salaries, and unfortunately, our department over there salaries are below average. So the number of people who are calling and coming by is just phenomenal. How much has it increased, Tammy? You got any idea?
Yes. I would say we see about between 400 and 450 people, counting calls, claims, and benefits for dependents with us two folks. And we did bring in In 2015, Alamance County veterans received $78 million in benefits in this county.
And a lot of these guys are, and ladies are in very, very bad shape. And they seem to be forgotten most of the time, but this board, I think, recently has really, really done a good job to help us out.
We need to. They've done a lot. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. Next, the health department. Stacy.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Tis the season for budget amendments, it seems.
It is.
So I come before you tonight to request a budget amendment. The health department was notified by the North Carolina Office of Minority Health and that we have been awarded an allocation of $230,105 to create a regional collaborative, which will engage and screen and provide a minority diabetes prevention program to our minority communities. And the reason this is so important is that in your packet you'll see that pre-diabetes, and that's what this program is basically to combat. Pre-diabetes is a condition where people have higher than normal levels of blood glucose in their bodies, but not to the level where they're actually diagnosed with diabetes. So this is that stage right before. And in 2013, the prevalence of diabetes in North Carolina was about 9%. And of those that responded to the behavioral risk factor surveillance survey, of those, about a third of them were minorities. So without intervention, each year, about 11% of those will convert to diabetes. So in Alamance County, diabetes results in about 270 hospital stays each year, and an average length of stay of about 5 days with each one of those cases. The average charge per case was about $20,000. So also in, as of 2013, the diabetes was the eighth leading cause of death in our community. So one of the contributing factors for diabetes is obesity. Consistently, about a third of our Alamance County population is obese. Services around food, education, nutrition, and physical activity, which are all addressed in this minority diabetes prevention program, are potential ways to reduce the burden of obesity and therefore reducing the burden of prediabetes and diabetes in our community. So I bring forth to you the allocation for a budget amendment and approval from the North Carolina Office of Minority Health.
Just a question, the collaborative for regional, who all will be involved?
So it's Region 5, we're called Region 5, there are nine counties. It's Guilford, Alamance, Orange, Durham, Caswell, Person, Chatham, Randolph.
Okay.
And there's one more, Rockingham.
That's spreading that out pretty thin when you start going across that many counties.
So I was impressed with the level of detail of this program that comes from the state, really. And they say this is evidence-based, so these interventions have been tried other places and it works.
That's correct. So this is a CDC evidence-based approved program that would be implemented in our nine counties. Alamance County would be the lead agency for that. And we would be partnering with our hospital partner, Alamance Regional Medical Center, to lead that regional collaborative. And then the other health departments would have their lead liaisons and also have lifestyle coaches trained as well. And we act as a fiduciary agent as well.
So I noticed that there were several time constraints as to when certain things had to be done, and
yes,
they're pretty tight.
They're very tight. Yes, yeah. Training starts in a couple weeks.
So you gotta get busy.
That's right.
Well, I think being the health person on the board and being on her board of health, I would like to make the motion.
All right, thank you, Bob.
Sure.
Thank you, David. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
All right, very good. County Manager, do you have a report for us?
We got one more, the jail.
Oh, I'm sorry. The jail. I'm guessing you're the jail man.
Got a budget
man.
What name?
David already approved.
I need to present it, Sheriff.
Do what?
Would you like me to present it?
Please do, because nobody told me I had it on there.
What this budget amendment does, commissioners, is it budgets our 2016 State Criminal Alien Assistance Program grant in the amount of $31,870, and it corrects the revenue that was budgeted involving $19,000.
Is that you?
Yes, sir, that's me. Why didn't you say scalp?
Scalp. There you go. Any questions? All right.
So moved.
Thank you, David.
Second.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sheriff, for waking up back there. Caught him off guard. I can't believe it. All right, now we'll get the county manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just want to mention, you know, our next meeting, we will be swearing in our new board. Appreciate Mr. Lashley being here and also Ms. Gailey. We're going to have a reception over at the Youth Services Building right after the meeting. So to welcome the new board, but also to thank Ms. Massey and the judge and Roger for their work. And we do want to make sure that if there's anybody special you want us to ask, let us know. We'll make sure to invite them. And we will do that at, right after the meeting on December 5th. And that's all I have.
All right. Very good. Commissioner comments?
That meeting is primarily for the new board, and it's the three of us duty to be here until our replacement is sworn in, so I'll certainly be here if the Lord lets me, but it's not our show. It's a new member's show, and I don't want to impede on that, so I'm going to give you my farewell here for a few minutes. At December 5 meeting, when I walk out that door for the last time, will be exactly 20 years to the day I came to work for the county. At that time, these commissioners, John Patterson, Junior Teague, Larry Sharp, Tim Sutton, and Bill Lashley hired me. And I practiced law with John for about 20 years at one time in private practice. Represented Junior Teague in a case that he brought against the telephone company where he lives down in Snow Camp area. And I got to tell you this story. It's not very long, but Junior sued the telephone company because they destroyed one of his farming equipment that was working in the cornfield because their line was too low and he hit it and tore up his equipment. So we sued him and had a jury trial over here in the court. This is when I was in private practice, not as a county attorney. And I told Junior before we went in, I went to the court, I said, Junior, I want you to wear your regular farm clothes. And if you will, put a little cow or pig dung on your brogans, and I want you to sit over on my left side, right beside the jury. And sure enough, Junior did. And as Junior was, he was smiling at all of them. Every time we'd have a break, he'd come in, he was shaking his head to them. And it went on like that for the whole time. They had a big fancy lawyer from Charlotte coming in representing them. Jury took about 5 minutes and came out and gave him every dime he asked for. So that's that was a very exciting time. I want to thank these individuals for giving me the opportunity. I was in kind of a bad part of my life at that time. I'd had a lot of defeats and disappointments in my public and private life, but my private law practice had been doing good, so I couldn't complain about that. That was primarily due to Dodd Blanchard, who was my legal assistant for about 25 years, and she knows how I feel about her. But at that time, I just didn't feel like I had accomplished many things, even though I had been a Superior Court judge, but that was 20 years before this time in 1996. So, as I said, these five commissioners gave me new life, and after that, things just seemed to thrive for me. It eventually led to me being elected to this board, and for that, I thank Terry Johnson. He has an awesome political machine, and he was very kind to an old man. That's what he called me. I've also had the privilege of serving on this board with some good commissioners, including all of my colleagues to the right, and Tim Sutton and Bill Lashley and John Paisley. But there's one other person I have to thank for my being here, really, and that's my good friend Howard Coble. As I told some of you, Howard and I started together as assistant county attorneys in Guilford County in 1968. I was a mere child, but I was ahead of my time. But Howard was always there for me. He was responsible for my being appointed Superior Court judge. He was the Secretary of Revenue at that time for the state under Governor Holzhauser. They were law school classmates together. I can't figure out whether it was 2 or 3 years ahead of me, but we were pretty close. I didn't know the governor at all. Howard was the one who got the appointment, and he recommended me for county attorney. He also recommended me for county manager, and he supported me for county commissioner. There's been a lot said lately in politics about political philosophy, how important it is. There have been some Republicans in the past who have questioned my conservatism, and I want to set the record straight before I leave. I voted for Barry Goldwater in 1964. Now, if that does not make me a conservative Republican, I don't think anybody in this room, or very few in this county, can match that. And when I voted for him, I had just spent 6 years at UNC, so that says an awful lot, I think. John Patterson said one time, John was chairman here on this board for about 7 or 8 years. And John was criticized every now and then because of how he voted, saying he wasn't conservative. But John Patterson's one of the most conservative people that I've ever known. And John was a born Republican. His family, they were Republicans here in Alamance County for, I'm sure, 100 years or so. And John was born into it. I was born and reared on Mill Hill in Burlington, and I was born a Democrat like everybody on Mill Hill, except for one man who ran the grocery store. And he was the only Republican, and we didn't know exactly what a Republican was back then. So, and let me say, I'm very proud to come from Mill Hill. But John once said that we were talking after one of the meetings, and he said, you know, I'm as conservative as anybody can possibly be, but you know, every now and then, somebody has to govern, which means every now and then, your principles are gonna have to be bent a little bit, and you've got to give, and that's the only way that you're gonna get anything done. I wish to thank my colleagues to my right. I respect all of them. I'm proud to have served with all of them. I thank them for their kindness and their recognition, I really do. But especially for putting up with me during this time.
We didn't hurt you, did we?
No, not at all. We haven't always agreed.
That's right.
But we have agreed a lot more than we disagreed, and any disagreements have always been very respectful and professional, and I appreciate that. I think we have succeeded in governing.
I think we have too, sir. Thank you for your service. Yes, sir.
Well, I'd like to say that it's been an honor for me to serve with Commissioner Smith and Commissioner Massey and Commissioner Parker. And as David said, we haven't always agreed on everything, but I've got to respect Commissioner Smith. I told him last time that, you know, I respect anybody who can get through law school, let alone be a judge and all the things that you've done throughout your life. And so I just am really honored and privileged to have served with you on this board.
Thank you, Bob. I have been with you too. Thank you.
And Commissioner Massey, the same thing. And you have a tremendous amount of background.
I know.
And experience.
I put up with every one of you.
You have.
And then with Commissioner Parker too. I'm sorry to see him leave because we've gotten along really well. And like you said, we've agreed on most everything as a board. And I think that we've done a good job of governing too. But I'll miss your humor sitting next to you.
I want to thank you too for allowing me to be the only female on this board.
You got one taking your place.
Oh yeah. Okay. All right.
You're the only female. I'm the only Democrat.
I'm a Democrat.
Very good.
No, thank you so much. It's been my pleasure to work with all of you. So you ain't gonna smack me or nothing yet. You want to smack me?
No, I thought you were gonna smack me.
Well, I feel like a designated sub or something like that. as far as my time on here, but I've learned a lot and I've really enjoyed it, and it's kind of funny. One time Bob said, after I'd been here a couple of meetings, he said, I really enjoyed working with you. I didn't know what to expect. And I didn't know if he thought I was going to bite him because I was a hardcore right Republican or not. But no, it's been an experience and I really appreciate it.
And I want to thank Craig too.
Executive Committee for the Republican Party give me a shot to do this.
Put up with us up here.
I'd like to be back one of these days.
All right. Very good.
Yeah, you ain't got but 5 years to get back.
Well, I'm going to hang it up in 5 years?
Yeah. No, you can come back.
Oh, I thought you meant I didn't have the 5 years to make it happen. Oh, Lord, you know something I didn't know about.
Basically, that's what it is.
She's predicting.
I appreciate all of the staff, Clyde and Greg and all of the folks, and enjoyed working with all of you very much.
Yeah. Well, I think when the day is done, I think everyone up here has worked very hard to make Alamance County a better place, and I think that is our job as commissioners, and I appreciate everything all of you've done, and it's good to have these conversations, and they, like you say, we may not always agree, but that's okay. That's mm-hmm. part of governing, and thank you very much, Mr. Smith, for being here, and Linda. Mm-hmm. It's been a pleasure working with you.
Thank you. And you too.
And we'll look forward to December and start again.
Start again.
There you go. No more comments. We will call it a meeting.
Good job.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.